All right, it's time to begin our Sunday evening service at 7 o'clock. Something different again. And I don't know what the people on the east side did, the people on the west again, but this happens every so often here, and they just move all over here. So we'll have to give them a lecture on being kind and loving and sociable. But we're glad everybody's here, mostly on the west, and we're glad that you've come. Enjoy, trust you've enjoyed this nice warm weather we've had. We've had summer for our day, and now we'll return back to our normally scheduled winter tomorrow, maybe. We trust we've come to worship tonight as we enter into this Palm Sunday weekend, and as we enter getting closer to Easter, as we've no doubt spent some time thinking about what Christ has done for us, the great love he had. Amen. And how much we owe him. We owe him our love. And that we can love and worship him and in this earth and be with him forever to come. Trust we'll find a book and do our best to lift in singing as Brother Maley comes and leads us in the Psalms.
To enjoy the beautiful weather today.
Amen.
Felt like spring, didn't it? Number 396. Number 396. And be ready for 334. 396 and 334.
Had wandered, all weary, sad, and lone, till Jesus, through his mercy, adopted me his own. Ere since I learned to trust him, his grace doth make me free. And now he's everything to me. To me, O
And if you could see, excuse my voice, I don't have much of one. But if you could see where Jesus has brought me from, if you could see what he's brought us through, and if you could just understand where he's taken us, you'd understand why we travel all over and sing for Jesus. We've got the message. We've got the songs. And there's a world out there that wants it. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Because that last stanza says, the Lord has been so good to me. I feel like traveling on. Until that blessed home I see, I feel like traveling on. And I've been good this revival so far. And I've let you stay seated. Because I know what it's like to be back there and like to just kind of sit back and relax and sing. But I just can't hardly think we can sit on this last stanza. If you're able to stand, would you please stand? Sing this with me. The Lord has been so good to me.
Amen.
The Lord has been so good to me. I feel like traveling on. Savior stoops down and reaches down and he'll pick us up.
Amen.
And then there's only one set of footprints because he's carrying us. He wants us to make it.
Amen.
And so what do you say, whether we feel like it or not, let's just keep traveling on.
Amen.
And I want to sing that last one again because the Lord has been
Amen.
So good to me.
Thank you.
Even when the tough times come, even when the hardships come, when the disappointments come, when friends despise and forsake us, the Lord has been
right.
So good
Amen.
To me.
Amen.
I'm so unworthy. I don't know if I'll get to sing much on this last one, but do it again.
Appreciate the truths in these songs. And I trust God will continue to raise up people that write these kind of things. We still need some new ones. And I know they are. But there's something about the old ones that have some depth of people that wrote what they lived and experiences they had. Well, we're going to look to the Lord in prayer this evening. And I know it's Saturday night, so we've got a big day tomorrow, but we're still here, and we're here for a purpose, so let's lift in prayer for this service, for Brother Martin as he ministers in word, and the Maileys in song, and that God will help us in this service today. Let's remember our prayer this year, lay Lord, lay some soul upon our heart, and love that soul through me. Our challenge for this year is to find someone that we can invite out through this year and get them to stick. And that's for you and that's for me. That's for all of us. That's our challenge to those that are part of the church here. We want to just continue to do that. And as tomorrow comes, being Palm Sunday, we'll trust to do our best. Just get one more person out for the services tomorrow. And then the following Sunday is Easter Sunday. Trust we'll have a good turnout for that service as well. Let's continue to remember Vern, Lisa, Phil Giardino, Larry Marsh and Lori, Bill and Bob. They've been missing. Continue to remember them. Jordan hasn't been out to the meeting yet. Trust he'll be out tomorrow. I haven't heard from him. Marlene's niece, continue to remember her with ALS as she continues to follow that awful disease through. Remember one of our former parishioners, Ted and Joyce Shepherd, lost their son this past week. His name was Teddy Shepherd, down in Rome area, Camden, somewhere down that way. There'll be a funeral. As long as everything goes well with me, I'll be holding for them on Friday. So let's remember them. They're older. Their son had some handicaps, physical, mental handicaps, and they had lost him, and it's been hard on them. So let's remember them as us, if we fill in for them and have that funeral next Friday. Let's continue to remember Chris Martin, Rodney and Brenda, the Northrops, Jaquess, and Quint. He texted me. He was unable to be here. He had to get tires on his truck. And our live stream audience and our Thursday night Bible club and Bible study and our friends down from Fine and Alexis that had the accident. The child was killed in Georgia. Again, the tragedies, the tornadoes, the shootings, this chocolate plant explosion, and many tragedies near and far. Political tragedies right now, awful messes there amongst the leadership in the United States. Let's pray for our leaders and the elections, our troops, war in Ukraine, so many things. It doesn't take long to look through the news to see some trouble out there. And it could almost be disheartening if we didn't have a God that was in complete control, that neither slumbers nor sleeps.
Right.
Anybody need to add anything to our list this evening? Marcia?
Prayers for the Silsby family. My cousin Mary has passed away 2 days ago.
Okay, Silsby, which is your cousin Mary. Okay. Let's remember this. Chad and Cindy. Yep. Yeah, I'm just in contact with Chad, and he's barely up and around. So remember him as he continues to get better. Our nursing home friends, Bucky's knee, always giving him trouble. And all the ones he sees there and the nurses he interacts with that he tells about the services here, maybe we'll see some fruit from there. Anything else? My son is out west, and he'll be traveling back, I think, tomorrow. Remember him in prayer. All right, let's stand together for a word of prayer. Let's bow our heads together. Heavenly Father, we thank you again this evening to be gathered here as we are tonight. We're thankful for your help and your strength. We're thankful for truth that comes and for the unparalleled privilege we have to sit in a place like this and hear the truth and hear it proclaimed so clear and so true and so easy to hear the songs and to have them before us and the thousands and hundreds of thousands of those that don't have those type of privileges to read the words of the songs that we read, that our heavenly home is bright and fair and God has been good to me, and to have that testimony, to have that experience and to have that inner knowledge that God is good. And we pray, Lord, that you'd help us to proclaim it near and far. Help us to shine the light from this community, this church, and from our lives at the grocery store and at the wherever we may go. We trust, Lord, you'd help us to lift the bloodstained banner high without apology for it. We pray, Lord, that you would be with the needs, those that are not here tonight, those that are here tonight represent needs in their bodies, in the physical, in each way. We pray that you continue to draw souls unto you. We pray, Lord, for those that have come in with burdens and trials and tests as we've shared around the table and around the place today. We all have been through experiences in life, but we all can testify that God has been good. We pray, Lord, that you would be in the service tonight, that you would be with each facet of it, Lord, that you would help in the singing and the preaching, Lord, to glorify you. Draw us unto thee. We pray for tomorrow's service as we Palm Sunday, as we draw souls in. We pray you'd be with the many, Lord, that would like to get out. Make it easy, Lord. We're just trusting for a good turnout and a good ending of the revival. Yes. Touch Brother Martin as he ministers, please, and we ask these things in thy name this evening. Amen. You may be seated. This time we'll have a special number and song before the offering.
Bless the Lord. D flat.
Are you in the right key?
No. I don't know what it's doing.
What key is that?
D flat.
When I look around and see the good things he does for me, I know. He's been so good to me. And when I think of what he's done and where he's brought me from, I've got so much to thank him for. And sometimes, while
I'm so unworthy.
And when I think from, I've got so much to thank him for. Well, I've got so much to thank him for, so much just to praise him for, you see. He's been so good to me. And when I think of what he's done and where that he's brought me from, I've got so much to thank him for. He's been so good to me. And when I think of what he's done and where that he's brought me from, I've got so much to thank him for. And when I think of what he's brought me from, I've got so much to thank him for.
Amen. Thank.
Amen. Who doesn't have something to thank someone for, the God for? He's been so good, so good. I remember, I might have shared this here, but worth repeating. I remember one of my heroes, D.P. Denton, talked about during the World War, he was ministering at the hospitals, and the chaplain said to him, "Brother Denton, would you go down the room so-and-so and go in there?" And he said, "Who is it?" He said, just go in there. Tell me. I'll talk to you when you get out." And he said, he walked in there, and he said there was a bed and head sticking out of a sheet. And he looked a little closer, and there was no legs, there was no arms. He said his ears were gone, his eyes, face was mangled. He couldn't talk, his mouth was wired shut, I think. He said, just before he went in, he said, "He can hear you, just so you know." And he looked at him, he said, "I was so overcome, I hardly knew what to say." And he said, "I said, soldier, I just want to thank you for what you did for me, and what you've suffered and for our freedom." And he said, "I just wanted to know, let you know that Jesus loves you, and you know him." And he said, that body that couldn't move, that body that couldn't speak, that body that was just a corpse laying there, basically, he said, it lit up like a 1,000-watt light bulb. And he said, he let me know that he loved you. He said, he couldn't talk, he couldn't run, he couldn't swat a fly off his face, he couldn't do a thing. But he had something to praise him for. It's not on this side of eternity. It's laying up on the other side.
Right.
Great and eternal. Paul taught us the law of the lever. He said this light affliction we push down lifts up for us like a teeter-totter. That great, but the pinnacle's been moved a little bit. He gives us the benefit. Just that light affliction is lifting up for us a far greater exceedingly weight of glory, he tells us, for those that are faithful. Amen. And I want to be part of that number. And we have so much to thank him for. We're going to come to you for the evening offering. Trust we'll do our best. Mind the Lord. Let's see here. Aiden, and is Kenton awake and amongst the living? There he is. We'll get our boys to help us tonight. All right, we thank you for your giving. Trust we'll do our best as the weekend closes out. Stand behind the needs. We all know what it costs to travel and to live these days. And we trust we'll do our best as the weekend comes. As far as announcements go, let's remember tomorrow, Sunday, Palm Sunday, and there'll be service here at 10:30. And there'll be the children's class and also the main service. Brother Martin will be speaking, the Mailies will be singing. Immediately afterwards, there'll be a meal provided at the hall up the road, and we're all welcome to attend for that. And then the closing service will be at 6:30. Back to our regular scheduled program. So 6:30 tomorrow night. Let's be praying for tomorrow. We're looking forward to it, trusting there'll be some visitors in, and that God will give us a good closing service on this Palm Sunday, and that He will speak to us in a special way. I'm just expecting there's just been something in the air today. I just kind of felt a little bit under a burden of it and just been praying for this revival that God would help us in the closing service especially. Let's remember again our speakers, Brother Martin, as he ministers and prepares, and beyond the here, the burden he carries for the whole conference and the responsibilities, and then the Maileys as they travel different places singing. We'll all be traveling in a week from now, Lord willing, if we get through our surgery and we all do well. We'll be heading down to Gatlinburg, and I expect all of us will be there, at least the minister team here. It'd be wonderful if all of you came down. It's an experience worth doing, but it's beyond the reach of some. But we're looking forward to that. It's a refreshing time, and trust we'll continue to pray. Any other announcements I'm missing? Oh, yeah. The Maileys do have CDs that they offer for sale. If you want to see them, if you enjoy their music, we have over the years. We never really got to connect with them until now. We've enjoyed this last couple days, but they do offer some CDs for sale. You have some with you, I assume. Yeah. So you can see them after if you're interested in that. And they have some music that's good and wholesome. And we trust you'll pray as they have another song. Brother Martin will give us the message afterwards.
That's okay.
The God who made the heavens and hung the stars in space. He made the moon and planets and put them in their place.
I'm sorry, that's my fault, sister.
Oh my word, honey,
I was a half step low.
The God who made the heavens and hung the stars in space. He made the moon and planets and put them in their place. He spoke the words so simply to bring the worlds to be. He took the dust of earth and made humanity. The God who rides the wind and calls the stars by name. His voice is as the thunder. He rolls the wind and rain. The God who measured oceans in the hollow of his hand. The God with a span, and the God of yesterday is the God of today, the God of all tomorrows will be the same always, the God of the ages is now and ever will be. David and brought the victory. The God who stood by Moses,
amen,
is standing now by me. And the God of yesterday is the God of today. The God of all tomorrows will be the same always. The God Satan and won the victory. The God who went to heaven and reigns in majesty. The God who feeds the sparrows and sees them when they fall. We'll see David and brought the victory. The God who stood by Moses is standing now by me. And the God of yesterday is the God of today. The God Satan and won the victory. The God who went to heaven and reigns in majesty. The God who feeds the sparrows and sees them when they fall. We'll see ever will be the one
Good to be a Christian and know he sees us and he's got his eye on us. Amen. Thank God for it. Thank you. Wonderful songs this evening. Thank you so very much. I've never preached this message on a Saturday night ever in my life and when I've done revivals, but I just couldn't get away from this truth that was on my mind. And so we're going to look at it this evening. It's a truth that has helped me a lot spiritually in my life. To learn things about God and get things established in my mind and life, and God to make some corrections on my life and my Christian life and give me strength and guidance, and it helped me so much in my Christian life. So I often preach it. I'm not a per se an evangelist. I'm a pastor first. And then when I pastor, God give me some messages that I end up developing as an evangelist when I go away to preach. But I've been pastor for years and years and years, and it says do the work of an evangelist as a pastor. So then I develop some messages that's what I do when I'm away. But as a whole, it's pastor flavor for lots of things because that's exactly what I was, a pastor. And love pastors, and two of them here. We love and appreciate, along with their families, and it's just good to be in the house of God. But I feel like this is what the Lord wants this evening. What we'll do at the end of the service, we got a 276 for our sister, 276 at the end of service. We'll sing first and last verse of that when we're done at the service. We often give an opportunity if somebody wants to pray about something to respond sometime during revival meeting, often our custom that I've been part of and done to kneel or sit in the front seats, whatever person would choose. And sometimes the preacher doesn't even preach on what God talks to us about. Isn't that amazing? God's speaking to us and challenging us in areas, and we just go up and pray about those things as we have opportunity to pray. Nothing wrong with that. It's just bringing things to God, and thank God for an altar, a place to seek God together, not to look down on anybody, not belittling anybody. Sometimes when I preach this message here, some of the best people in the church go to the altar. Best Christians. Best Christians in churches. Sometimes been pastors and pastors' wives. I'm not trying to influence this message. I'm just saying it's been some of the best people, the church, that as I preached this message, God spoke to, showed them an area to pray about. They wanted to focus on. Nothing wrong with that. Nobody de-Christianized them. No. We're all seekers after God, aren't we? What a privilege to seek after God. So we're going to open the altar, and if you have anything you want to pray about, and if it deals with this message, it can be about that. But again, God often speaks to us and often does in our life. Aren't you glad he does? I want to talk to you about out of a great revival text. It's Hosea chapter 10, verse 12. If you would, Hosea chapter 10, verse 12. I'm going to talk a little bit about fallow ground, what that means to us. Book of Hosea, a little harder one of those to find, but this is a great revival text. Been preached on numbers of years by preachers as an evangelist. It's just a real good text for revival. You would standing together, those that are able? Hosea chapter 10, verse 12. Thank you for being in the house of God. We thank you so much for taking time to come to the house of God, to bring your needs to God, let God speak to you. Just thank you for taking time to be here this weekend. Many of you were here last night. We thank you for being here last night. And again, many of you tonight, thank you for taking time to seek after God and putting yourself in a position for God to speak to you. We really, really appreciate that. Hosea chapter 10, verse 12, it reads this way. Sow to yourselves in righteousness, reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till he come and rain righteousness upon you. Sow to yourselves in righteousness, reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till he come and rain righteousness upon you. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the impact it has on our life. We pray, God, that you'll help us now in these next moments together as we try to share it. We pray, God, that you'll accomplish those eternal purposes that you've designed and you're working in our lives to accomplish. We thank you for everyone here, Lord, that's allowed themselves to be under your word, under the music, under the influence of the church. God, may it continue to be so all the days of their life. We pray, God, you'll help us each one to be clear with you and maintain being clear with you, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Charles Finney was one of those great revivalists, and he was asked, do revivals last? He said, no, but neither does taking a bath, but it helps to take one every once in a while. I'm not a farmer, to be honest with you. I never wanted to be a farmer. Of course, I like farmers, you know, because of what they produce. I was turned off by gardening. I told you that sometimes we had one of those lots in Millfield there, East Millfield, and in that lot, we'd, make a garden. I'm sure it was a lot smaller than in my mind because it was awful big when I was a kid. But if you notice, I'm very light-complected. You know what that means? I burn good. And after you burn, what? You blister. That's all I get. Never a tan. And my dad will put us out there to pull weeds, and as you can imagine, I have no desire to be a farmer or to have a garden. Oh, thank God for those that produce it. So I had to talk to some of my farmer friends, and they would agree with this definition of fallow ground. It's ground that once was tilled, but now lays waste and needs to be broken up again before it can receive grain. I've noticed that most farmers, at least around our area, will have a number of fields that they break the soil, they put the seeds into, and all of a sudden, you know what happens after a while? Their stems, crops start coming up. It starts happening. I also notice some of them same farmers often have a field here, a field there, that is fallow. And it's never going to produce unless they break up that ground again and they put seeds in that ground again and other things to make it right. And thinking about that, I thought, spiritually speaking, God wants us to be producing fruit as a Christian in our lives. So God sometimes will work in our hearts because there is this area, and we may be growing and developing here or there, but we notice there seems to be like a fallowness in a field in our life. And God says he wants to work in that. I agree with the writer of God's word. It's time to seek the Lord. Why do people have fallow ground, or why do I would get fallow ground? I suggest a couple reasons here. First, we're more concerned about someone else's spiritual lives than our own. More concerned about someone else's spiritual life than our own. I remember about reading about a pastor, and he had this problem with a layman in his church. He would say this to him as he would leave every sermon. Pastor, you got him today. Pastor, you got him today. And one day it snowed, kind of like we had, but you surprised us. I thought nobody would probably show up. Maybe they had to cancel. And you showed up, but not at that church. All the people missed, except one. You know who showed up at church? The preacher and one person. Yes, you got it. It was him. That said that to the pastor every week. So the preacher preached right at him and to him. Preacher thought, I wonder what he'll say to me today. When they got to the back, the man went out and he said, preacher, if they had have been here today, you would have got them. A question for us. Do we take a pitchfork to church or a spoon? A spoon or a pitchfork? We know the difference, don't we? I don't want to be fed with a pitchfork, do you? No. What do? You throw that to the other. But a spoon you take up and you take it yourself. We've got to go to church, every one of us, with a desire to get from God. The truth is, Paul said this in the book of Corinthians, he that compares himself among himself is not wise. Why did he say that? Because we can always find someone less spiritual than ourselves to compare ourselves to. And when we compare ourselves to them, guess what happens? We look really good as a Christian. But the truth is, we're not comparing ourselves to any other person in the church. You and I are backing up to Jesus. And we go comparing ourselves to him and how patient he is and how merciful is he, how forgiving he is. And you and I just keep backing up to him. All of a sudden we see there's areas in our life that we can use God's help in personally. And as we go to God's house and we go to the services with that intent, God just has a way of helping us, doesn't he? I've seen this sometime play out this way. People have a tendency to focus on their strengths and not their weaknesses. I remember a person saying, everybody ought to pray more. Can you disagree with that statement? Everybody ought to pray more. Well, how about this one? Everybody ought to testify in church. Everybody ought to testify in church. I've heard it. Yet I know the person well enough to know that they would hardly ever testify outside of church. They're very good at testifying in church. And there's nothing wrong with testifying in church. But their problem wasn't that. You see, they magnify what they were good at in a Christian life and forgot the weak over here that need God's help over here in some area of their life. And we can develop fallow ground. We focus on that on other people. I remember my son Ryan, as he got to that age, he's growing up, he got saved just as a little boy. He's a teenager, and it's tough for him to testify in church. You know? So anyway, he come to me. I'm his pastor. And said, Dad, on prayer meeting night, you call on me to testify. And you know what I said? I said, I'll do that. So after people testified for a while, I then said, Ryan's going to testify tonight. Isn't that good? And I did. And you know what happened after a while? He overcome that weakness. I told the people where I was pastoring, if any of you want me to help you, just let me know. I'll put you on the list too. It's okay. It's okay. But you see, Ryan found a way to overcome. And sometimes it is. We get other people involved in our life to help us to overcome. Oh, thank God for that. Thank God for that. The second reason is we've developed fallow ground is it can develop is because we don't make seeking God our chief, first, preeminent, whatever word you want to use, I mean, right there top, Christ. The Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things shall be added to you. Matthew 6:33. It's tricky, isn't it, growing up? It could be a part-time job, and a person's never had it before. First time they're getting $60 and $80. The older person that's got $400 are like, whoa, why are they having problems? Why are they struggling that? Well, that person has never done it before. Or they get their first girlfriend or boyfriend. Oh, what's wrong with them? Nothing. It's just that sometimes their affections naturally so. It's okay. But you know, it's going to have to be guided by God. Relationships. But older people, same way, other issues in our life. That, you know, it gets us caught up. And Christ is supposed to be first. And he starts to slide down the list of priorities of other things in our life. God cares. And sometimes it can be simply of they become of greater focus than Christ. The cares of life can choke our spiritual lives. I remember this verse, Colossians 3:2. It says, set your affections on things that are above. I remember going to Penview, and I was playing ping pong at home. But when I got to Penview, they had a bunch of really good players, and I started playing a lot, and I started getting better, and I started, you know, learning how to, like, return spikes. Isn't that fun? I mean, when they come over there, you know, like, that one way, and you're able to return it, you know, it's really nice, not to laugh, you know what I mean, but just, oh, if you return a spike, you know what it is. Anybody play paintball? You know what I mean? Oh, fun, isn't it? And then when you learn to spike and they start working for you, oh, that's really fun when you make that. Or you just kind of defend. You're feeling pretty good. I bet I played quite a bit. I'll never forget coming out of that basement, dining hall, come up and around, and that cafeteria door was there. And I heard this Bible verse. Set your affections on things that are above, not on this earth. I called you here to pin you to learn how to preach, not how to play ping pong. That's what God spoke to my spirit. You know how he does, don't you? It wasn't necessarily like an audible word, but yet in one sense it was audible. I understood it perfectly. God set your affections on things that are above, not on this earth. I didn't feel like God was telling me, you can never play ping pong again. Some people have, and that's okay. But right there, you know what I did? I bowed my head right at that door. I said, Lord, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Went over to the dorm room and prayed and told God I'm sorry. Then every once in a while in my life, God brings this verse back to me. I told you it's helped me the rest of my life. This message has helped me the rest of my life. Because if I get something else out of order in my life, God just, set your affections on things above. Remember ping pong? Slow down, put it in order. Ain't God good? Because he wants us to love him first, then others. For a little while, maybe we can shift the sign. You're really used to this up here, colder weather. The ponds, lakes. Which is the best time to break up that little ice that comes on? When it first comes on, you barely break it up. That's a good time. Or should we wait for 18 inches? I went fishing with a guy that had an auger one time. The only time I ever went ice fishing, the reason I went in, because he had an auger. And I wanted to see him do that through that ice. That is amazing. It was impressive. But I would say that you're better in your spiritual life and my spiritual life to deal with it when God first speaks to the issue, then ignoring the issue, and us getting a hard heart. I want God to speak to me that I take care of things in my life very early when God speaks to me. I know you feel that way. A little while, look at it. First, a neglect of the Word of God. Neglect of the Word of God. I'm not talking about remembering everything you read. We don't remember all the meals we ate, do we? Now, I know it's a good thing for me tonight that I ate a good meal because they had me ring the bell. Now, I better be careful here because I told them I wouldn't go for somebody tonight. But anyway, I had a good meal and anyway, I was able to ring it and not jump up through there. So it was a very good situation. But I don't remember every meal I've eaten. And the devil come around when we've read God's word. He said, what do you remember? What do you remember? I'm not a very good Christian. You don't remember. Well, I'm just telling you what's important. Just like the food you eat, you don't have to remember what it is. But it is important that God's word feeds us. And every once in a while when we're reading it, it ministers to us. It don't have to be every day. Just like you don't have to get all caught up with all you're eating. All that. No, you eat, it takes care of itself. But spiritually, we want God's word to impact our lives. And allow it to speak to us and help us and challenge us. I thank God for his precious word. My wife is not a reader. Okay, she's not a reader. She don't read a bunch of books every year. Do we have any readers here? Do we have a few readers? Yeah, I like reading. Until my eyes, I start getting these migraines, and then I'm have to listen more than I used to. I don't like it, but I preached for years. If you can't read, listen. And she has a Bible app. Isn't that a great thing, a Bible app? Because I have one on my Bible. It's amazing how much you can get out of listening to God's word. I'm just saying, Christians, let's don't let the devil defeat us because we fail in one area. There's so many ways that you and I can have God's word impact our lives and come into it. Listen into messages, but don't forget God's word, whether it's CD or whatever it is. Let's let it impact our life. Take some time letting it speak to us. If we don't, there'll start to be a hardness on our life. And God's word will not go into that ground, and we won't start producing the fruits that God wants us to do, because we've got to be receiving his word into our lives. I asked God one time, I pastor for a lot of years now, so every once in a while I ask God a question. It was this: God, why do some people stand and why do some people fall? Why do some people stand spiritually, Christians, and others fall? Because I know some in difficult situations, all kinds of cancers, families don't follow God. I mean, everything against them. And they just stand for God. And someone else with a lot less things fall from God. So I say to the church, God, why is it? What's happening? And the Lord gave me his own words. He says there's a wise man and there's a foolish man. And Jesus taught the story, and he said a storm's coming for both the wise man and the foolish man. And what did Jesus say? The wise man and the foolish man did something identical. You know what it was? They both heard the word of God. Both wise and foolish heard the word of God. Oh, thank God for hearing. But Jesus said the wise man not only heard, but he practiced and he did the word of God. Let me put that in a practical way. Galatians 6:10. We hear it preached, or we're reading our devotions. We read Galatians 6:10. Do good, especially to the household of faith. Isn't that a beautiful verse? I love trying to win people to Jesus so you can save that which is lost. Part of the Great Commission. I'm all full of that. But do you see what that says when I'm reading the Bible? It's not talking about Great Commission there, is it? Do good, especially to the household of faith. Christians, do good to Christians, especially. We need each other. Strengthen each other. Now, how can I do that? I can sit in church, hear that preach, and go home and do nothing with that verse and become only a hearer of God's word. Or I can say, you know what I'm going to do this week? I'm going to call up Sister So-and-so from the church. She wasn't in church. She's a Christian. And I'm going to do good to the household of faith. I call on the phone. I make a personal visit. I go to a nursing home. I'm just saying, there's a Christian. I reach out and I contact them. Facebook, I can't do that, but some of you can. And you can practice the Bible right on Facebook and make it for the glory of God. Isn't it beautiful? But here's what happens if we're not careful as Christians. We're saved for a while. We start coming to God's house, and all of a sudden, we just start becoming hearers of God's word. And I know there's a sense, if God gives us where he wants us to be as a Christian, we come to church and we start to practice hearing and doing. Isn't that good to become part of our life? We get in the real routine of life, and that's who stands. When the storms come, it's those that are hearing and those obeying, applying the Bible. Oh, God help me. God help you. Not to fall into the snare of fallowness that happens when we quit practicing God's holy word. Make it part of our life. Neglecting the means of grace. Neglecting the means of grace. What that means is, I'm not talking about we don't go to church. Christians should go to church. You know why? Lots of reasons. But one of them, because the Bible says so. Hebrews 10:25 says, not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together, as the manner of some is. Some people's practice, it says, is going to be saying, I'm a Christian, but they don't go to church. Or they don't go very often. It's always been. ever since they've been part of a church. Here's what the Bible says. That's what some of them do. But that's not God's will. It says to go, and we're exhorting one another, and so much more as you see his day approaching. What is that, his day approaching? Well, we sang it about it tonight when we all get to heaven. His day approaching, as we get closer to the second coming, we should go to church more, not less, because we're going to encourage each other as Christians to be faithful to God. Thank God for it. I'm talking about something else. I'm talking about we come to church excited. We're anticipating God moving in our midst, God moving on our hearts, God helping us to see his will for our life. I remember when I was pastor at Sunbury Church, they had a glass window in the back so I could actually see everybody come in the church door, and I'd often greet them as they did. But before everybody got there, I was already down the church. I'd been praying before the service, and then I stopped and went back before anybody come. And I'm sitting back there, and I saw in the yard there was this baby robin. You know how they are with that big old giant head, proportionately. Next thing I know, here comes a mama in. And I'm they're only about that far away from my glass, just barely in the yard there. I was watching her, and then mom flew in. You know what mom had? Mom had a big old worm, a big one. You know what mom did? Mom tore that big worm into pieces. You know what she did with it next? Because here come the baby. I meant mouth open. And mama put those worms right in that baby's beak. Isn't it awesome how God takes care of them little creatures? But then I felt like the Lord spoke to me and said, if you go to church tonight expecting me to meet with you and help you, I am going to help you. And you know what he did? He did exactly what he said. When I went expecting him to help me, guess what? He got food for me. It'd be through the singing. It may be somebody's prayer. It might, well, when they're taking the offering, somebody prays for that offering. It touches my heart. It strengthens me. We edify one another in the house of God. God uses it. And when you come to church expecting, God is going to feed me. God is going to teach me today. That's what we got to have. Makes the difference. And when we don't have that, we run into a fallowness that we're not receiving into God's, the soil, so it can bring forth the fruits in our life. Third, a neglect to be careful about spiritual things. Lightness in quoting scriptures. Charles Finney made this statement. If Christians themselves have deep feelings on the subject of religion, they will produce deep feeling wherever they go. If they're cold, light, trifling, they'll also destroy all deep feeling, even in awakened sinners. We need to make sure, Christians, that we're not using God's name in vain. It's one of the Ten Commandments, isn't it? Not to take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. And then it says something else. I will not hold you guiltless. You know, music's fun. But I've been around Bible school a lot. And some of that fun stuff and preparation for songs. It's okay. But we have to be careful. Because every once in a while, we go over these lines about God's name. I'm not trying to be picky. Because I don't look for things just to pick on. I'm saying what God spoke to me about. And I believe it's right. God is protecting his name no matter how you and I feel about it. He said, you're not held blameless. That's my name. And we surely wouldn't want to use it like some people do, and we wouldn't. But I'm just reminding us Christians, be careful of that name. It's hard. It's his name. Amen. Don't you love him? Amen. But if we do, they'll become this fallowness. And you got to say, son, daughter, take care of it. Stop. Make an adjustment. Receive the grain so you can have fruits in your life in that field. This is my last point. Neglect to seek the Lord. We neglect to seek the Lord in prayer. Our text talks a lot. Sow to yourselves in righteousness, reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till he come. and rain righteousness upon you. Neglect to seek the Lord in prayer till he rains righteousness upon you. I thank God for every short prayer. I pray prayers, and I know you have too. It's only been like, Lord, help me. Look. Yeah, hadn't it? You may have been driving. If you've ever rode for me, you've had a few prayers while you drove. Oh, it's always them. Well, once in a while, it's me. You know what I mean? That one would have been my fault. But we pray, don't we? Often we pray. Afflictions, pains, and we just pray a quick prayer. Oh, aren't you glad that God answers them quick prayers? Oh, thank God he does. Keep praying them. Keep praying them. But I'm here to remind you, the Bible reminds us, it says this, men ought always to pray and not to faint. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. I remember giving pen view at the Bible school. I'd never given blood before, so I volunteered to give it. I'm sitting there eating the snack, which every college student likes, and I'm eating that snack. And then all of a sudden, I said this, I'm feeling a little funny. I tell you, something really tremendous happened. They brought over a wheelchair and had it sitting right by me, and they helped me get up and sit down in a wheelchair. And they started to back me up and going to take me through that little room out in the hallway, and there's a door that they had open then. I wasn't quite there yet. I'm still on the backward part, heading across that room. And I don't know, but I'll explain it like this. It was like there's light all over the place, and then there's, it goes like this, and then it goes, it's getting darker. Did anybody here ever pass out before? Does anybody ever pass out? Yeah, okay. It's not a good feeling. I hope you don't. And it went almost to the end, and all of a sudden, they put that salt stuff up my nose. I go, woo, that's not very nice. Well, it was nice, and I didn't pass out that time. Oh, it was great. Listen to what the Bible says, men ought always to pray. Some battles are longer than 1 minute prayers. Sometimes they're bigger. We're not smart enough, strong enough to live a Christian life to other than God, but God must rain righteousness upon us. What is that? It's the ability to do right. And sometimes you're going to have to pray more than 30 seconds to have that happen in your life or my life. We're going to have to seek God in prayer until God rains righteousness upon us, the ability to live and do right. The best way I can remind you that when your knees start to shake, you feel like you're going to faint, pray. God can restore. God can send righteousness, and God can revive you and me. When's the last time we felt God's presence? We felt an amen. We felt a testimony. The Spirit of God in us that way. I started pastoring a church when I was 21 years of age. I was a Christian for 2 years and 4 months. God opened up a door to go to a church. There was nobody believed like me, but I was asked to go. It was a little community church, and it was going to turn into a church for God's Missionary Church. I was going to Bible school there, and I started to, the door opened, and I said yes, and I was going to go down. In those old days, there was no piano player, so I'd try to lead singing by myself. And you had to do quite a bit of praying by yourself. I had to preach. Of course, I still had to study for school, all my classes, and then go down and preach. And that was routine. I did really good for about 3-4 months. Just kept it up. Lord's helping us. And then I hit something. I didn't know what it was about. I didn't know it was the devil trying to defeat me, pull me down, all these feelings, because now I am like raising my hand. I raise my hand in worship. I don't say you have to, but I do. That doesn't make, I say so the service isn't interrupted as often. Because if I said amen or praise the Lord every time I raise my hand, it'd probably be pretty loud. So the Lord let me raise my hand. I say amen every once in a while or praise the Lord, but that raising hand, that means I agree with that. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for doing that for me. I appreciate it, Lord. But all of a sudden, I started raising that hand, and there wasn't those feelings that I was feeling for so long. It's like not there. And I'm preaching and talking to people, and it feels like I'm going through like this motion, but I'm not feeling God's presence like I want. I didn't realize the Bible has teachings on it. When you start preaching, guess what? The devil's going to fight you. The devil doesn't want anybody to be preachers. He don't want anybody to try to talk to people about the Lord. The Bible says, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing has happened to you. I wasn't able to figure out what was happening. Why am I feeling all these strange feelings? Not feeling those things I felt like I need to feel when I'm preaching. So the devil's fighting me. But you know what God does when the devil fights us? The Lord teaches us. And the Lord's so good to us to teach us. You know what the Lord taught me during those times? It is not hypocritical to praise God no matter how you're feeling. It's not hypocritical to praise God. God is worthy of worship no matter how you're feeling or how I'm feeling. He is our God, the Creator, the Redeemer of the world. He is worthy of praise no matter what. Then think about it. Jesus had a big lesson along this line, didn't he? The disciples come back and they cast out demons. That's pretty big stuff. And they were praising, exciting, telling everybody. But you know what Jesus said? Don't rejoice in this. What? What? Lord, I thought we're supposed to praise you for everything. Shouldn't we praise God because the devils are being cast out of a person? Surely we should. But not this time. Because Jesus had a big message for them. And they needed to get it. Because sometimes in doing church work and ministry, you're not always seeing everything happening good. So what if it's going bad? Well, I guess we can't praise God because it's bad. What Jesus say? Rejoice in this, not that the demons are subject to you, but rather rejoice because your names are in the Lamb's book of life. You're saved. You're forgiven. I'm forgiven. There's nothing better, and we can always praise God because we're forgiven. Oh, isn't it wonderful to be forgiven? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. There's a big difference between lukewarmness and dryness. Lukewarmness, the Bible says in the book of Revelation that God would spew them out of their mouth. That's serious stuff, lukewarmness. Lukewarm person doesn't even care. Christians, good Christians, can be dry spiritually. Not feeling the presence of God like they like through events, death in families, all kinds of things happens. Dryness is consistent with godliness. You know what happens with that person that has a dry heart? They say, Lord, I don't like it this way. That's a good heart. Not liking it that you're dry. Not liking it that it's not what you want or has been in your life. Oh, thank God for it. Last illustration. I was up at Penview at the Bible school, and this bothered me, and I'm out walking and praying, and what the Christians around me told me when I got saved, if you go through a difficult time in your life, keep doing what you know you should do. Keep going to church, keep reading the Bible, and keep praying. Doesn't matter if you don't feel anything, getting anything out, you keep doing what you know you should do. God's coming your way, and God's coming my way to help us. So I was doing that. I went around school to walk and pray. I get in the back, and Penview soil there at the Bible school is shelly and a bunch of junk stuff in it. Not like Lancaster County, PA. That's a whole different soil. My Penview, it's rough stuff. And here comes this farmer, Pennsylvania Dutchman, Bernard Walters. And I've seen him as I come around, and I sit down by this tree, back against the tree, and just looking out there praying, but not really praying as far as not getting anywhere from my perspective, you know, so I just stop, and I'm sitting there. I heard this tractor, and here it comes. And I watch him. It's an old tractor. Old one. Has three or four plows. It's a real old model. Small tractor. He comes across that field, and next thing you know, he puts that plow so it's going to take into that soil, the shell, and all with that is there. And I start to watch him as he goes through that. And you know what happened to him? As he's going through there, he gets stuck. He gets stuck. I'm watching him, and he's not going to get out of that. He is stuck. You know what he did? We got some people that know how to run tractors. Some will be very ignorant right now. I don't know which way he shifted it. But he added in forward, and now he's got to make it go backwards. So he shifted it in reverse. But do you know what it is to try to get a plow that's stuck down out of that to back up? It is very difficult. But that was his only option, because he's not going forward. And all of a sudden, you see him as he starts to try to go back, and he's looking back there, trying to pull that to get out of that, and it just vibrates, and finally, he breaks loose, and he goes back. Then he shifts it again. You know which way he's heading this time? Forward. To the same problem. To the same shell. To the same thing that got him stuck. And he just starts, and he goes right heading for that. And he hits that thing, and he bogs down for a minute, and there's this great struggle. But you know what happened? He plowed through. And he made it all the way to the end. The Lord spoke to my mind and said, son, that's what you need to do. You are bogged down with good things. Church, school, all these things I've called you to. I said, oh, Lord, I am bogged down. He said, I want you to put in reverse today. Reverse. Yeah. Reverse. You remember? I told some of you. I left my seat here. All this guilt of sin in my life. Doing a youth service, and young people were testifying. I went back to that service. How God spoke to my heart, how I left that place and seat, came and prayed at that altar, asked Jesus to forgive me of my sin, and Jesus took away that guilt in my life and gave me his peace in my life. That's what I did. And how many prayers he started answering in my life. How he brought me to school, and he worked out all these things right there in my life. And you know what happened? Guess what happened? God rained righteousness upon me. Terror comes down my ear, eye. And I'm crying and praying, thanking the Lord. God's got me through this. God's going to work out the rest of the details of my life. And he did. I thank God that he can restore, he can refresh, he can strengthen us as we serve him. I want us to stand, if you would, with our heads bowed. Going to, again, 272. I'm going to sing this first and fourth verse. Then we're going to give an opportunity, if anybody want to pray, you can come while we're singing and talk to God about anything he put on your heart before the service, last night's service, this service. God's just been speaking. You got something you want to pray and talk to God about. So welcome to kneel at this altar, sit on the front seats, and we'll have prayer with you. God's calling. Let's sing it together, the first verse. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Are you coming? I told you at the beginning of the service, no shame in seeking God. No shame in seeking God. What a Savior. Listen. Hold me and make me after thy will while I am with.
till all shall see Christ only always living in me.
We're no more singing. We're just going to wait. She's playing another time. If anybody else wants to pray, a couple's come to make it easier for anybody else that wants to seek the Lord. We're going to gather to pray no matter what tonight with them. Then maybe you want to bring something to Jesus. A good night to bring it to Jesus. Come quickly. Come quickly. Step out. Best thing I ever did was step out seeking God in my life. Anybody want to come and pray? Join these that are here. I'm coming, Jesus. I'm going to talk to you. You coming? Come quickly. Come quickly. Others are coming. She's playing through one more time. One more time. God's here to help her these needs. Several here praying. How about you? How about you? She's playing one more time. When she's done, we'll be done. Take advantage of the opportunity. If God spoke to you, God's speaking to you. Oh, what a privilege to pray to Him. Oh, rain that righteousness upon me, the ability to live right, do right, refresh, renew. Whatever it is God speaks to us about, I just want you to work in my heart, Lord. Work in my life, Lord. Come quickly. We're gathered to pray when she's done. If you're coming, come quickly. No shame in talking to our God. What a privilege. Anyone else coming? What a privilege to bow our knee before Him. Let's gather and pray for those that are here. Thank you for seeking the Lord. Let's pray for each one of these that God will be with them in a special way. Ask our sister to keep praying if she would for a moment here. Father, we thank you for your privilege of serving you, loving you.